Hey everybody, Nick here. I deeply apologize to anybody who got a going live notification and just got kicked out of the chat. I'm really testing this new YouTube going live app, and turns out the internet speeds I've been using weren't quite high enough. Made some tweaks, I'm gonna see if that helps a little bit, but unfortunately the only way to test this is to try it out. And I see some people are coming back in. I'm really hoping that I'm gonna be able to get upload speeds worth a damn here, and that I won't lose out on the connection again. But, we'll find out here. So again, apologies for anybody who got kicked, or for the people who are getting notified who don't give a damn that I go live. So, good to hear it. Let's see if it stays working. What's my favorite thing about the TiLock from Gavin Reddig is the first question that comes across. There were a lot of favorite things about the TiLock, but for me, I think the favorite thing is the carryability. Note, this is a millet clip on here. It's aftermarket. I'm going to do a review of it coming up here soon. A hillbilly knife nut, but the carryability of this guy is really what, you know, drives me crazy. I love it so damn much. I mean, if we compare it to the Grimsmo Rask right here, blade length-wise, they are very, very similar, but handle-wise, they are very, very different. The TiLock is much smaller, and that's because it's got this lock mechanism here. It's a beautiful thing. So, that's my favorite thing about the TiLock, is the ability to do that. Let's see here. Kilo Watt asks, hey Nick, getting ready to work on a new Delica. Assuming there's red Loctite on the pivot, what should you be able to do? So honestly, Kilo Watt, I'm feeling a lot lately like working on the Delica is not a great idea. I recently took this Endura apart and it was hellish. Like seriously. There has got to be a Dantean circle of hell dedicated entirely to people who are, well, I don't know what you have to do in life to be in a position where you got to take apart Spyderco Delicas and Enduras, but it's up there. You can definitely do it, absolutely 100%, and the way to deal with red Loctite, although I haven't seen as much of it coming out of the Japanese factory, is to use a bit of a soldering iron to heat this guy up. Be careful not to hit the FRN with it, but still. You just want to make absolutely sure that if the screw is giving you any resistance at all, that you apply a little bit more heat, you give it a little bit more time. That may be helpful to you there. But ultimately, like I said, I don't necessarily recommend that you take apart the Delica anymore. I'm half tempted to take that video down altogether and put one up also with the Endura. Just saying, you know, probably not. Not a great plan. So let's see here. It's the fifth circle. Yes, JC Lebedev, that's definitely it. Rodrigo Teresa asks, Manix 2 full flat grind, the Spyderco PM2. It's a great question. I've only got a PM2 handy, but that's not actually a knock on the Manix, because this is a great knife, the PM2 is, but the Manix is also a very nice knife. The Manix, in a lot of ways, is a little bit more ergonomic. It feels a little better in the hand, so if I were in a position where I needed to cut things all damn day long, I would probably end up using the Manix more than I use the PM2. The PM2 is a little bit more of a beater, if you will, but they're both very, very nice knives, and I feel like you're not really going to go so wrong there. That's something important here. Let's see here. Other questions. Matt Rose asks, do you miss your neon at all? That's a great question. Honestly, no, not so much. The only thing that I miss the neon for right now is the fact that it would be nice to compare it against the Shiro, against the Grimsmo Rask here. I think that'd be an interesting comparison. But the Neon is a great knife, but it's also now a great knife that's living with a buddy of mine. So I feel like it's a, I don't know. I feel happy that it's found a new home where it is truly loved. Maybe someday a Neon will come back into my life, and if a custom one landed in my lap, I might still consider that. But by and large, I'm pretty happy still with my decision there. The $700 is a little bit better. Farouk from the Bright Orange Bearings Department wishing you a great day. Thank you very much there, Farouk. Sorry, guys, by the way, the questions do, they fall off the screen pretty quickly. So if you don't see me with a, if I don't see your question, feel free to ask it again a little bit later and I'll catch it. Somebody just asked, a wolf just asked me if, how I feel about beating up high-end knives. For instance, would I use a Grimsmo knife for construction? I mean, the biggest question there that you gotta ask yourself is, well, are you willing to injure that knife? at some level, you know, the Norseman or the Rask, more so the Norseman, feels a little bit beefier for whatever reason. It's not a bad knife for construction, or the Razel is a great example of this. This is a knife that I do things that are a little bit cruel to. And, you know, I have no problem with that because it's a tool that's that deserves to be used. If I'm just babying it, if I only take it out of the drawer every so often and flick it once or twice, and then it's a, then, I don't know, that strikes me as a sad thing. That said, if it's a knife that means a great deal to you because of the money you've got in it or otherwise, don't hurt it. I mean, or be kind to it. I mean, you can see already today I was carrying this Rask and, well, I'm already using the blade. I'm already using, I mean, any knife that I own and I carry, I need to be able to use. But otherwise, you know, I say use it. But if it's too expensive for you to use, if you don't really love it, move it down the road. But that's my own philosophy. I don't believe necessarily in safe queens. That's no knock at anybody who does, but there you go. Anybody else have vid or still waiting? I hope we're not having more connection issues here. But there we go. Somebody just asked me, let's see here, why are Benchmade's Gem 3319, why are Benchmade so more expensive than knives for other companies? That's a really good question. So, for starters, that's making an assumption that Benchmades really are that more pricey. There are some knives in Benchmade's lineup that actually don't strike me as a terrible value. The Benchmade Contigo, it is a big chunk of M4, it's a big knife, and yet the price of it is pretty reasonable, all told. A big part of that reason, though, is that Benchmade used minimum advertised pricing in order to increase their prices sometime back in, I want to say, like 2010? Someplace in that vicinity, 2009, a Benchmade 140 was going for $125, and then they did MAP, and overnight it felt like the Benchmades all just went way the heck up in price, and that was ugly, and it was sad, and it was frustrating for fans, because it's like, okay, wait a second, this was a $120 knife, and now you're telling me it's $170? Really? But, so that's as near as I can tell, that's the explanation I got. That said, like I said, they've got some value issues, and honestly, I think the biggest thing for me in Benchmade, at least, is that the quality doesn't match the pricing. The MAP thing can be just fine if you're doing something really, I don't know, if you're doing something perfect, and you're charging a high price for it, that's A-okay. But when you're charging $170 for a knife that's built like a $70 Kaiser, that's not a knock on Kaiser, by the way, I'm not so thrilled about it. So there you go. Let's see here. Rimarox, good question, by the way. Rimarox asks, hey, Nick, my Sage 5 is kind of stiff, and the compression lock is pretty painful on the fingers. Is this normal? You know, it depends. I mean, a compression lock, there's got to be a little bit of pressure here as you disengage it, or else the knife, that lock bar tension needs to be a real thing there. So, past the point, your fingers get a little bit used to it, but at the same time, it could be that there's a little bit of an issue there. What you might consider doing is blowing it out with some compressed air, or doing a full disassembly if that's something you feel comfortable with, and oiling it up a little bit might help too. But, you know, if you're in a situation where you don't think it's right, send it back. Spyderco, although it doesn't have the greatest warranty in the world, they do try and stand behind their people. And frankly, it's a good thing for manufacturers to see back knives that are a problem, because it makes them realize that they've got a problem. So there you go. Good question there. So let's see. St. Jude La Soul says, congrats for the new Grimsmo. Thank you very much. He's talking about the Rask here. This was my EDC today, and I still like this knife a lot. I was just sitting there as I'm waiting for code to compile or otherwise, just flipping this guy back and forth, which is just a beautiful thing. So I'm a big fan of this guy still. I'm not quite ready to say gem yet, but it'll be a little while. Rimarox just responded, another thing to take into account is that I got it yesterday. That's another thing to take into account. A lot of knives will take some time to break in, and a compression lock knife, particularly running on the Fosper Bronze, it's not a bad idea, as silly as it seems, to just sit there on the couch and do one of these things for a little while. Watch an episode or something and just let the bearings wear in a little bit. That'll help you out. Let's see, Sage 5, a pair of 3. That's a great question, and it's one that I mean to do a video about, but I just haven't. Look, the basic answer is that the Para 3 is a great knife that's a little bit more hardcore. You're getting a slightly bigger package, it's wider, and it's a little weirder in the pocket with the pocket clip. This is the Para 2, by the way. The 3 is with the buddy at the moment. But anyways, the Para 3 is a little bit bigger, but it's also a little bit more hardcore. The Sage 5 is, frankly, a slightly more... It's a nicer gentleman's knife, and I would say it's probably a better EDC choice for most people. So, there you go. That's kind of my conclusion, is that by and large, you're going to want to stick with the Sage 5, but the Para 3 is good if you're a little bit more serious about things. Somebody just asked me, Lava List Secretary, somebody who works for an insect company, I gather, asks if I can show how the rask sits in the pocket with something or another. Sure, let's use this. This is a piece of paper here. I don't feel like I need to explain that, but there it is. And we're just going to drop this guy right on in to the pocket. And it sits very nicely. This is a nice knife in the pocket. And because it's so damn thin is the other thing to remember, it carries better than, frankly, its size would expect. This is not a tiny knife. I in some ways, one of my borderline disappointed. I'd hope that this guy was a little bit smaller. Because, I mean, practically speaking, the blade on this is still pretty serious. But nonetheless, it carries relatively small, which is nice. Let's see here. Dobrin Sabu asks, favorite language to code in? Good question. Probably Python. Doesn't need compiling or anything, and it's just, it doesn't have some of the craziness of, like, MATLAB or otherwise. So there you go. Great question. Brock Whittle says, what up, Nick? Nice to see you. Good to see you there, Brock Whittle. Nick Carter asks, how worth it is the TiLock? That's a really great question. And by the way, these are all a lot of great questions, guys, but the TiLock is a knife I go back and forth with because it's freaking expensive. I mean, seriously, as it's constructed now, I want to say it's like $475 retail, and I've got a $67 clip on it. That's expensive. And so every time I recommend the TiLock, I feel like a jackass. Because honestly, this is a lot of knife. But the thing is, I really, really do like this, and there isn't another knife that's out there like it. The Buck Marksman has a similar sort of backstrap lock, although it's implemented very differently. But I really do like this knife, and honestly, if my TiLock was lost tomorrow, I would probably end up buying another one. So there you go. It's a lot of money, and if that's an amount of money that's silly to you, especially on a knife that's not as serious in some ways. I mean, this is A-okay for EDC. It's a great EDC knife, but it's not like a hardcore, hard-use sort of an affair. If you're okay spending that much money on a very, very nice-looking, very, very nice everyday carry choice, the TiLock is just fine, and I have no problem recommending it despite that incredibly high price. When am I going to upload my review and disassembly of the Kershaw Skyline? So that's this little guy right here, for those of you playing along at home. Kershaw Skyline. This is a very nice little knife. This is a knife that I actually purchased for the channel, and the problem is that at any given moment, and I've said this before, but I have a bunch of loaners on the channel that end up taking precedence because I want to get people their knives back. So for instance, right now, I have this little guy, which is a Ferrum Forge Scepter, which is really interesting. Very, very smooth action, I'll say. As well as this little guy, which is a Southern Avo. And I'm not remembering the name of the viewer who sent these along, and I feel like a total jackass. But whoever you are, remember, he's a Redditor even. It'll come to me. But anyways, thank you very much for sending these guys along. I got them safe, by the way. And, you know, I've also got an Endura that's on loan. Jonathan Barber, hey, you're a gem. Thank you very much for sending these guys along. I appreciate that. See, that was convenient. He was in the chat. But anyways, and that they got here safely, by the way. These are very, very nice. And so I need to review these guys, as well as the Endura I've got, as well as some new releases. I do have a Delica. This is something I haven't shown on the channel yet. This is a Delica, Spyderco Delica, but it's in a serrated blade. And I'm kind of an idiot. I did not intend to buy a knife in a serrated blade. I don't tend to like serrated blades on knives. However, it turns out that I clicked the wrong damn button. And so that's silly. But nonetheless, I'm going to do the review because it is a serrated blade. And so I got to see how a serrated blade actually works for everyday carry in my life. So I'm just trying to make it a Bob Ross-style happy little accident. But to get back to the original question, the Skyline is coming, but it's there were a bunch of other knives on the table before it. Anything that's new, anything that's loaned, that sort of an affair, and so it's something I'd like to really do and spend some more time with. By the way, this guy is relatively new to the channel. This is a Boost Blades Arrow. Boost. Very nice little knife in a lot of ways. Absolutely. I'm not willing to make any statements yet, but it is a very, very nice knife, and it's a knife that I actually chose to buy as a reviewer. So that should probably tell you something. This is a member of the permanent collection. Nice little knife here. And so look for a review of this guy coming up here soon. That's another one of the ones that I need to review getting up close here. Let's see. What's my favorite Bob Ross quote? Dallas Gonzalez. Hey, Dallas, you've loaned me some stuff. Thank you for that. Dallas, my favorite Bob Ross quote. Honestly, I've always been a big fan of him taking the paintbrush and beating the heck out of it? Something along those lines, along on the easel. I don't know why, but it always brings me some joy, and frankly, just a happy little bush. Look, if I can be as entertaining as Bob Ross, then I'm doing something right. Because he's such a chill guy. And it's a shame, because I'm kind of known in a lot of ways as being more negative than most as a YouTube reviewer. And that's frustrating to me, because I don't want to necessarily be a downer. I don't necessarily want to be ugly about things. So I try and keep it happy. Beat the devil out of it. Thank you very much. So, you know, I'm trying to keep some of that positivity involved, because really my negativity comes out of a passion. Maybe it's not apparent there, but for me, when I'm really, really sad and angry about a knife, it's because I'm disappointed. It's not anything else. I want every knife to be a gem. I would love that, nothing more. If I could go the rest of my days and everything I review is just an unequivocal gem, I would wish for that future in an instant, in a heartbeat. I don't get any pleasure from doing a negative review, and in fact, it makes me sad when I get something in the mail and it's just like, I don't like this. So, you know, it's always tough for me to maintain that balance. And, you know, when I gripe about things, you know, it's a real thing, but it's just I'm trying to give constructive criticism to make the world better. But, you know, who knows? Favorite locking mechanism? That's a good question. So, I mean, considering that every knife on this table, well, okay, the Z-Hunter is its own special little guy, and the TiLock is a weird little lock, but the majority of my collection are actually titanium frame locks. So clearly I'm a big fan of titanium frame locks. But that said, the compression lock is really a joy to me. I do love the compression lock because it gives you kind of the best of both worlds, a nice flickable action as well as a nice drop shutty sort of affair. So, you know, that may be my actual choice. I really do wish that more knives were made with compression locks, and that's one of the reasons that the Smock SK23 just brought me joy. Hey, Gamma Raybust. So Gamma and his family, whose names I'm Celeste, I want to say Brian, they are very regular contributors on the Patreon and commenters and whatnot. So that's a beautiful thing. Thank you very much, Gamma and family, for your generous support there. Worst thing is apathy. Yes, absolutely. Wizzub says, worst thing is apathy. Cough, Aegis Hoplite. Yeah, the Aegis Hoplite was a really tough knife for me, as I mentioned in that review, because I really didn't give a damn. I mean, it was a fine knife, and, you know, if that was the knife I had, I would make do with it absolutely 100%. There was nothing so wrong with it, but there's nothing so right either. And those are really, really tough reviews, because it's just like, I just don't give a crap. And so there you go. Pete, that's right. Sorry about that, Pete. Gamma Ray Burst, that is. So Waffle asks, Nick, you've never reviewed an auto. Are they not legal in your area? What's the deal there? Actually, a couple of things. Yes, they are not legal in my area. That's a part of it. I could do reviews on them at the table, but the thing is, I honestly don't really, I'm not passionate about them. I lack any real desire to go deep into it with the auto knives. They're just, I don't personally, and again, I'm not crapping on the folks who like the autos. I don't wanna pee in your Cheerios here, but I don't see the advantage of an automatic knife over something like this. What is so much easier about pressing a button here than pressing the button here? It's no faster, it's no different really, it's just, it's a different approach. And so for me, an auto just doesn't make all that much sense. I'm not saying they're a bad thing, and there were some wonderful auto knives out there. When I went to the Blade HQ, I actually got a chance to handle a bunch. And so a Microtech Halo, which is ridiculous, absolutely, Microtech Ultra Tech. The Trodon was actually the one that I liked the most there, for whatever that's worth. So there you go. Thoughts on knife rights? You know, honestly, Rodrigo, I haven't spent enough time thinking about it. I appreciate Knife Rights as an organization that's trying to get a, it's trying to advance legislative change on knives in the U.S. I don't know enough about their methods to really be able to comment too much about that, but I do support the goal of making knife legislation more sane everywhere, frankly, because knives are tools at a fundamental level. And, you know, so I'm a big fan of anybody who's attempting to remind the public of that and to remove some of the fear-based lawmaking, because fear-based lawmaking is a terrible, terrible thing, in my humble opinion. Let's see here. Oh, Gamma Ray Busty, it's Pete, Lisa, and Celeste, and Alex, your son, that's right. Sorry about that, but again, they're supporters, and they get a shout-out here. Thoughts on the head design's equilibrium. Anyways, the Equilibrium is a knife that Frankie and the Bird have, and I've thought about asking them to review. It's not my style at all, and I'm always a little bit torn about knives that are just deeply not my style. Should I still review them? Should I still go after that? Because I'm not going to be as passionate about, for instance, a knife with a huge backswept blade. They don't tend to really bring me that much joy, but at the same time, knives like the 452CF here, this ZT, this is deeply not my style as well, because it's huge and it's murdery, but this is one of the best knife designs out there in production. And so I still have to respect it. So I probably should do a review one of these days. I just haven't yet. But that's a really great question. Are the Boost Arrows available? Where did you score it? Thanks for your reviews, says Greg Wilson. Thank you very much for the kind words, Greg. The Boost Arrow here is, I believe, available through the knife maker, William Boost. And I actually got this guy from him. He sent this guy along for review, despite my little message of, which I send to anybody who wants to send me something from a manufacturer of, you know, realize you send me this, you got no control over whether what I'm going to say. I could call this a gem, I could call it junk, I could tell people to run out and buy one, I could tell people it's a piece of crap. And, you know, even despite that and advising them that they shouldn't get lawyery if I give a bad review, despite that, he sent it along. And so that takes some stones. I'll give him that any day of the week. And frankly, it's a very nice knife. I'm waiting to do my review on it until I spend a little more time. But as I said, I got this off of him and I actually made the decision to go ahead and buy it off him. So that's probably a good thing. Let's see here. Am I planning on getting a GEC at some point in the future? So, Great Eastern Cutlery, and thank you, who said that? Knives, Gear, and Life. Hey, Eric Losh, good to see you. GEC makes traditional knives, and I've said a bunch of times, traditionals don't tend to bring me joy. They tend to use nail nicks more often than not. And frankly, I like a lot of the conveniences of modern folders. Things like a pocket clip, things like easy deployment mechanisms that don't require a nail nick, which I hate. And even modern steels. So, personally, I feel about traditionals a lot like I feel about autos. They're great things, and that they can have a use, and a lot of people are passionate about them, but I'm just not. And so I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time with them. I'm not your guy for traditional reviews, sadly. You know, I've thought about trying to go there, but every time I do, I just feel like, what am I offering the world? I should be reviewing the things I care about, because that's going to be a better video for you guys. And my time is really finite lately. So there you go. Any plans testing more Z Hunter models? I feel bad enough. Like, I stay up at night worried that I am supporting the Z Hunter company. Like, at some point in time, they're going to have a conference. Like, our sales were flat, but then Nick Shabazz came along. That keeps me up at night, because that's ugly. But maybe, you know, sure. I definitely want to review more low-end knives. I mean, right here on the table, actually, is a Walmart Tan Flipper knife, which is a really, really solid sort of knife. in the gas station tradition. I'm not advocating that you buy one of these. For the love of God, no. Note that I put an incredible edge on it with the KME learning the new system. But anyways, I mean, it's important to me to review the low end as well as the high end because it gives me perspective. I mean, I can say a lot more about the Greensmo Rask after handling this little guy. The flipping actions are slightly different. The smoothness on the knives is, well, a little bit different as well. Come on. No. Let's see if I can... There we go. Hey, there we go. So it's important to me to stay on that low end as well. And it helps me from being just a complete jackass of a snob. Because I am kind of a snob. I'll be real here. I'm a very lucky man to be able to have a collection like this. And, you know, not everybody can. And so I want to make sure that I don't completely lose myself in the high end. Let's see here. What else? Will I ever send my Rask to Birdshot? So, Birdshot IV, Frankie and Bird are buddies of mine. If they asked for it, I probably would, although they're going to need to wait a little while, because damn it, no, this is mine for now. I would probably send it to them for a loan. The thing is, they're not big fans of the Grimsmo brothers, just because, and I've heard this from other people as well. John Grimsmo, and I don't really, Eric doesn't talk as much about things, but he's said before that he doesn't consider himself a knife guy, that the majority of knives that he carries are his own. And I can see for some people, and for Bud particularly, that is an issue. You know, I can see why people would feel that way. For me, I look at it as the results. You know, I don't care. You know, I don't care what the heck John Grimsmo does in his free time and whether he loves whatever else. He's making great knives, so I can't really argue. But Bud has got a little bit of a... He doesn't care for that so much. So, there you go. Let's see. I just checking here. What's the knife on the far right? This right here is the Booze Blades Arrow. Been mentioning it a couple of times. So that's a nice little knife right there. Let's see here. Just trying to keep an eye. Jacob Aldridge is claiming to be Nick Shabazz. I'm sorry to say, Jacob Aldridge, you're not Nick Shabazz. Unless I live like a Fight Club style double life. In which case, well, I've got bigger problems than who you are. Let's see here. The Native is the best knife I don't own. So, yeah, Jason asks, why you say the Native is the best knife you don't own. Why don't you own it? That's a great question, Jason. Thank you. The Spyderco Native 5 is a really stellar knife, and I've bought one twice. The thing is, though, the Native, here, I'll bring out the Delicas, because that's kind of the comparison point here. The Spyderco Delica and the Native are very similar. They've both got FRN construction. They've both, although the Native has a much nicer steel, an S35VN, and I believe the Native's made in the States. But for me, they fill very similar niches. They've got similar blade shapes and styles. The thing is, though, the Delica just carries a little bit nicer in the pocket for me. This guy sits off to the side in the corner. The Native is a little bit more blocky. It's a little bit more of a rectangle. And as a result, I'm not as big a fan of carrying the Native. So every time I've owned one, I've felt like, you know, it's a nice knife. I like it a lot, but it's not something that's going to get pocket time. And again, it just comes down to, for me, if something won't get pocket time, I can't afford to keep it around. That's the only way that I can afford to have some nice knives, is to keep my collection fairly small. So there you go. That's a great question, though. Let's see. Do I plan on showing my face? So if you look at Ask the Nick Volume 3, I believe, I tell you that you have already seen my face out in the world as is, when that scared coworker comes into your office and asks you, hey, Nick, can I borrow your knife? This box isn't coming. Right there, you see my face, smiling out over the room. As for actually showing my face, honestly, no, it's probably not going to happen at this point, mostly because it's become a bit of a running gag. You know, I it's like Wilson from Home Improvement or something along those lines. And so I enjoy that, and frankly, it could also be a distraction at work. Not that anybody actually gives a damn, my boss knows, but it's just like, I'd rather not go there. I like to keep my work and my play separate, and, you know, doing this is definitely my play. So there you go. Kind of a weird definition of play. Oh, yeah, and the fact that I'm Batman. That's another important factor. I don't want that to get out to the Joker and whatnot. Cricket Razel, somebody asked. I forget who asked. Wow, the comments are coming fast and hard now. That's a beautiful thing and poorly phrased. Oh, Nick, what the hell? Sorry. Cricket Razor, there we go. Yeah, I got a review coming up for one of those. Frankie and Bird sent me theirs along. Interesting knife. I really wish it was better made than it was, but it's a cricket, so I wish that about pretty much every cricket. Sorry about the heat kicking on there, by the way. But it is still a nice knife, so there you go. Am I not running the custom clip on the Delica anymore? Yeah, I used to have a Lynch deep carry clip on this guy. The thing is, the Lynch clip on the Delica was never as compelling to me because it messed with the ergonomics a little bit in the back here, and because I don't like the disassembly. You have to kind of put your driver in at an angle, and that's a good way to strip a screw. So I'm interested in some additional deep carry clips, but honestly, I like this clip a lot, and if it ain't broke, don't fix it. It's also, as a reviewer, I'll say, I use the Delica a lot for comparisons, absolutely, and if people are constantly asking me, wait, my Delica doesn't look like that, is mine a fake? That gets to be a little bit frustrating, so at some level, there's a lot of value to having a closer-to-stock knife on the review table. So, there you go. Hey, Chris RTW, what are some good places to buy pocket clips? It really depends on the knife. There are good people out there who make them for a variety of ways. Millet makes clips for the Chris Reeve knives that are very expensive, but also very nicely made. Who else? Lynch, I've got a review of some Spyderco clips. Another manufacturer, I want to say MTC or something along those lines. MXG? Something MSG? No, that's the stuff at Chinese restaurants that gives you headaches. Either way, one of those companies is making new deep carry clips for the Spydercos, but still, there you go. And yes, Sananchi says, gotta go. I hope this video is recorded for later. Yes, that is one big difference between the Instagram live streams and the YouTube ones, is that the YouTube streams are entirely recorded. So somebody who misses this will see it later. So it makes a little more sense, as an Ask the Nick. By the way, we got ourselves a little plug here. If you're not following me on the Instagram and you use the Instagram, go ahead and do. It's a great way to see a knife that's, you know, what's coming onto my table that maybe I haven't reviewed yet. So you might see things like, oh, he's got himself a one-cliff Delica, or, you know, hey, Ferrum Forge Scepter, cool, etc. So those sorts of things. So check out the Instagram if you give a damn. Let's see. Ryan, hypothetically speaking, if somebody trashed the washers on their Endura during maintenance, how would they go ahead and keep the action smooth without them? Hypothetically speaking, if your friend trashed the... you're asking for a friend, I'm sure of this. If your friend accidentally trashed the washers on an Endura, what I would actually do is email Spyderco about it. Worst case scenario, they say they can't send them along. Then what you might be able to do is ask on a forum and see what size they are. Very often you can order washers from like an Alpha Knife Supply or something like that, put them in there. But that is one of the biggest frustrations for me with Spyderco, actually, is that they don't sell parts. They will sometimes, and they're getting a little better about sending out parts and things like that, and they're going to have to with the red Loctite thing that they're having trouble with lately. But I really do wish I could buy a parts kit for the Delica that had all of the screws, etc., washers. That would be a beautiful thing. So there you go. Matthias Mertens asks, plan on doing any more Chinese knives? Some people are kind of annoyed by it. So, I got no problem with knives that are made in China. That's not an issue for me particularly, because I look at it as it's competition. American knife makers, European knife makers, Russian knife makers, whatever, you know, they just have to keep up with the trend. And, you know, nobody in China is making something that is as high quality as, say, the Grimsmo here. And Chris Reeve knives is really towards the top of the game in terms of quality, and China's not knocking them off that post yet. Rayot, Kaiser, Wei, Reich are doing similar, and they're doing great work. But still, the way to beat that is by increasing quality and by increasing value. And ZT is doing just fine. So I'm not in the, you know, oh my God, it's a Chinese knife. No. That's not my shtick. That said, some of the cheapy Chinese knives, knives from companies like, there's a CH company out there. You know, I got a video coming up about that. They're kind of dice roll knives where you buy one and it's like you roll the dice. Maybe it's a good one. Maybe it's a bad one. But regardless, that's a little bit ugly, and I'm not going to spend so much time on those. Similarly, Chinese knives that come with zero warranty at all. So companies like, let's see here, Real Steel. This guy, thanks to my buddy Peter over at Cedric 8 Outdoors, who I think was in the chat earlier, who also sent the Buck Vantage. featured prominently in my Rask reveal video yesterday. Sorry about that. Real steel can make some great knives, but unfortunately they have zero warranty and support. And given some of these are in price ranges along with knives that are made in the States, you know, I have a little bit of trouble with that. And so those ones are right on the edge for me. And Gonzo, I'm gonna steer clear with, because so many of what they do are just outright, not clones, because they're not claiming to be the exact design, but they're really, they're homages. It's ugly. So there you go. James Kier, don't speak Welsh, but whatever, asks, is Benchmade ever going to improve their QC? So I got a joke for you. Did you hear that the QC team at Benchmade asked for a refund at the Leaning Tower of Pisa? Yeah, looked fine to them. Okay. Yeah, I've been sitting on that one. Anyways, I hope so. Benchmade was my first love as a knife guy. That was my first high-end knife, was a Benchmade Emissary. And it really does bother me in a very real way. I give them crap, and they deserve crap, because they're putting out crap. But I really do hope they come back. I think it would be a real tragedy if Benchmade as a company completely went away, and we lost designs like the 940, the Valet, the Contigo, the Adamas, some of the really unique stuff that Benchmade is doing. What I would really, really like is for them to get everything back in gear, and to go back into competition, to go head-to-head with ZT on quality, or with Spyderco, or any of these other companies. And they can do it, they just don't give a damn yet. They're banking on their brand name, and they're eroding it quickly. Because in my mind right now, Benchmade is synonymous with great designs terribly done. And that puts them in the same category as CRKT Cricket, and that's ugly. So, yeah. But Benchmade still does make good knives. If you go to a local store and you can get one that doesn't have horizontal or vertical blade play, so no, none of this and none of this. Actually, here, let's use a good example. None of this and none of this. You're going to be happy. I think they still do make good stuff. So, great question there. ZT, Nanchi says ZT has been killing it. ZT really has. They are really one of the better consistency production knife companies out there. I did a video on the Spyderco Sleesh Buoy sometime back, just talking about the joy of the details, and I'm thinking I'm going to do another one based on this guy, the 0452CF. This is really a much better, better knife. Let's see here. Boulder Bro 959? Ah, nice. Asks, have you ever thought about getting into sunglasses? No, because honestly, I don't wear sunglasses. I wear glasses. And so, for me, it's kind of a waste. At one time in my life, did wear contacts on a regular basis, and then I wore sunglasses. I was a big fan of, Oakley's were pretty good. What is it, Maui Jim? Did some decent work as well. But honestly, it's not an area I'm passionate about. It's not an area I use every day. So it's not an area I'm going to spend much time. I really like the channel kind of as it is. I focus mostly on knives. I do love doing the watch stuff. The Omega on the wrist at the moment. Customary wristwatch check. And I do love doing pens. You know what? I may branch out here and there. I got a couple of reviews coming up of some lighters. I don't smoke, but they're still very good parts of your EDC, and may do some other miscellaneous EDC stuff, and maybe even some audio. Come on now. There we go. Little peanut lighter. But anyways, a little fiery. Come on. But I'm really hoping to stay relatively close to my core here. Is the Omega mechanical? No. If you'll watch here, you can see that it's ticking along perfectly accurately at 0.2 seconds per day, and that's just a beautiful, beautiful thing. So there you go. Paul Maciejuk, I'm sorry, I'm not really very good with Polish, as you can tell from my pronunciation of the name Maciej Sleesh. Nonetheless, he says, really appreciate your videos. Besides knives, what other kinds of EDC gear are coming soon? Well, like I said, I'm doing some lighters. I'm also going to be doing a video or two talking about some spinners. This is a thing that's taken the everyday carry community by storm, these little guys. And I got a couple of them coming in from buddies of mine all over the world, actually. I got a guy who hand spinner reviews on Facebook. A nice guy is sending me one. I got some other guys all around, so I want to play with that a little bit. So let's see, knives and gear for life. What are your experiences with ball bearings, pocket lint, and dirt? Do you clean more often because of it? So A very common criticism, and a completely fair criticism of my disassembly videos, is that I use way too much lubrication. And in some ways, that's true. They run a little bit smoother for it, but you need to clean them out more often due to pocket lint and things like that. If you want a knife to stay good forever, very often you run it with very, very little lube. I drown my knives, and, you know, I don't mind cleaning them. I don't mind taking them apart. But still, it's a little bit, I don't know, it is true 100% that pocket lint, and especially when you oil knives like I am, can be a problem. This is part of the reason why if you've got a knife that you absolutely need to have work always, whenever, whatever conditions, honestly, washes, phosphor bronze washes are the way to go. You know, there's a reason that the Chris Reeves Sebenza runs on washes. And so there is a soft spot in my heart for a good knife on washes. The this little guy, the Gareth Bull Miura here, is a very, very nice little knife that's running on phosphor bronze. It doesn't need to be on bearings. And, you know, it's got an action that's fine as it. So, you know, ball bearings are... Well, frankly, they're a double-edged sword. You can get a lot of beautiful, beautiful action out of them, especially when you put both of them back in. And, you know, you can get great stuff, but you also pay a price in maintenance and that sort of an affair. Jason Ng asks, hey, Nick, what do you think of the Kaiser Feist, the new $200 front flipper? I think that they better send me one of those. Kaiser, to their credit, after my last set of reviews, was very generous and said, you know, hey, great reviews, thank you very much. Even though I kind of really crapped on the Uprising, they were still very happy for the constructive criticism, and they offered to send me some new stuff, and I asked specifically for that one. So I'm hoping that they do that, and if they don't, if they decide for whatever reason they don't want to send me any other gear, I'll probably pick one up on my own. Because it is a really interesting design to me. And I think it's also one of the more interesting... There were some front flippers... It's a neat thing. The idea of a front flipper where you don't have the pocket pecker in the back, it's a different opening mechanism. It is a really wonderful kind of thing, and I need to see more of it in pocket knives. And I've got some information that there are some front flippers in the works. I can't really talk too much about it, but there were some gems coming down the pipe. So there you go. Let's see. Takinia Superbus asks, Superbus, sorry, Superbus. Latin. Tarkinius Superbus asks if he wants to buy a high-end flipper. Go for Rask and Neon. So personally, I would go for the Rask. I've owned both, and I like the Rask a little bit more. It's got a little bit more panache to me, and although it's a little bit bigger, it is smoother and, frankly, nicer. Rasks are really hard to find, though, is the other issue. Right now, people are charging stupid prices for them. Like, you know, I'm seeing them going up for, like, $10.95 or something like that on eBay. That's opportunism, 100%. It's somebody who got one and then just decides they want to turn it and make a quick buck on it. I don't know that I would be happy with myself if I paid that much for this knife. I like this knife very much for what I paid, but past the point, yeah. And I paid around, I think it was like $670, something like that, which is a good chunk of change, but it's not that much. So there you go. Zach G says, you don't need a pry bar when you've got the Norseman. One of the Grimsmo brothers, that would be Eric, posted a video of him using the tip of his Norseman as a screwdriver. I saw that video on the Instagram, and I cringed. I'll be real here. You should never use a knife as a screwdriver. Knives are tools, but not that kind of tool, although the razor is a perfectly serviceable chisel. So that one, I'll say, it hurt me a little bit, but then again, he can resharpen his anytime he'd like, and if anybody's going to break a Norseman, it might as well be one of the Grimsmos. So, you know, it's his choice, but, you know, at some level, use it. If it brings you joy to use it as a screwdriver, use it as a screwdriver. If you are if you abuse your knives and that's how you enjoy them, then do it. Absolutely. They're not objects that you just want to, you know, stare at and fondle every so often. Use your stuff. Seriously, guys. It's beside the point. Let's see here. What was the front flipper I pulled down from up top? A shot. This little guy right here, this is the Gareth Bull Miura. I'm going to have a, sorry, another one of the questions just popped up. I'm going to have a review of this guy coming. I'm just waiting to get off the honeymoon with it. Great, great knife. So somebody just asked, let's see here. Let's see. Maram Ovidiu asks, since you don't care for automatic knives, do you drive a stick shift? So that's hilarious. No, I don't drive a stick. Just because it's one more thing I got to deal with. I'm not a high-speed, low-drag performance driver sort of guy. I drive like a freaking granny. I am a really boring individual. I think people underestimate just how boring I am as a human being. And my driving manifests this in many, many ways. And so, you know, I don't feel the need to eke every last bit of performance out of my cars. And frankly, I don't have cars that super performy. So, no, I'm not an automatic driver. I can drive a stick. I'm not great at it, but I can get by if I need to. I think that's an important skill to have. But, you know, it's not something so stellar. Let's see. Sabas Argelio. I love you, Argeo. Sorry, I completely butchered your name. Thank you very much for the kind words there. JC Leberev says that Nick is actually a Delta Force member. Yes, you caught me. I am high-speed, low-drag, tactical operating, operationally every damn day. I'll play with the lighting here a little bit. Great questions coming in here, guys. And by the way, it's 44 minutes into the stream now. I think I'll probably cut it off about an hour. So make in there. Gray Man asks, what's your 9-to-5, IT monkey? So I've talked about this a couple of times in the Ask the Nick series, so I'll send you there. But I work with sound at a fundamental level. I do a lot of writing code. I do a lot of analysis, things like that. I'm a scientist, basically. It's the way it comes down. Weizhu Lin asks, you'd like my opinion on Microtech OTFs. I'm not a big fan of automatics. Microtech makes some great automatics. I don't like the screws, but they actually make sense on automatics because those are dangerous to take apart, and it's hard to get them back together. So it makes sense there, but, you know, Microtech makes good stuff. I'd love to get my hands on a Hawk Deadlock one of these days. G&G Hawk have made one that's supposed to be great, but, you know, they do fine. So there you go. Jacob Douse asks, have you handled the A2 from Boca front flipper? No, I haven't yet. I'd like to one of these days, but Boca I don't tend to go out of my way for. The quality is a little bit such that I don't feel that comfortable buying one for myself. I'm gonna pop on the light in the background there. That'll help. Okay. Let's see here. Don Cisneros, like your voice. It's cool. Hey, thank you very much. Very, very few people agree with you. It's amazing how many of the comments I get are just hate on the voice. It's spectacular. A squared. Oh, okay. Well, whatever it is. Nope. Nick drives like a Norseman. Smooth. I wish. I drive like a jackass, which is not like a Norseman. Well, maybe a Norseman's a jackass. What do I know? What's my opinion on the Benchmade 940? I've got a bunch of reviews up. Check it out. Hey, B. Sollenberger. Good to see you. The 941 review kind of really sums it up for me. That they're fine knives, and if they were at a better price point, I'd be much more likely to recommend it. The Benchmade 940, just plain, is a wonderful $120, $110 knife that they're selling for $170. Take that for what it's worth. Let's see here. Flaming Edge asks about face reveal. Already covered that early in the video. The voice and the jokes of the channel trademark, it wouldn't be the same. Thank you, Eric Loesch. I'm a big fan of that, though. The crappy jokes, I'm really surprised you guys stick around. Let's see here. Do I have experience with ZDP 189? Oh, boy, do I have experience. Right here, Spyderco Dragonfly ZDP. ZDP is a great steel. I love it very much, especially on a knife that you don't want to be able to, or you don't want to have to maintain for a while. The nice thing about ZDP is it keeps an edge roughly forever, so it's a great knife for travel and things like that if you're going to be away from a sharpening setup for a while. Solid, solid, solid. Recommend a budget front flipper. Oh, I wish. There are very, very few good front flippers out there. The Boca Excalibur, not the Excalibur 2, but the regular Excalibur. The Excalibur 2 is a piece of crap. Or is it the other way around? Either way, do a search for Excalibur Nick Shabazz on the YouTube and you'll find my reviews. That's actually a pretty decent front flipper. It's pretty big, though. I'm hoping that more people come out with lower-end front flippers one of these days. Let's see. Mara Movidio asks, what is your buddy, the mysterious stranger, up to these days? I don't know. I haven't talked to him in a little while, but I'm sure it's cold up there in Siberia. So, let's see. Face reveal. It's right there on the far left. Oh, yeah, right here. My face. The thing is, when you stare into the abyss stares back into you. I recently, for the Patreon, story time. I recently, for the Patreon, purchased 35 Z Hunters. Because it's a Patreon reward now. Anybody who pledges $50 a month or who cumulatively reaches $50, I send you a Z Hunter. It's a way of giving back to the Patreon subscribers who really make this channel possible in a lot of ways, along with the people who loan me gear and otherwise. But nonetheless, I had to purchase 35 Z Hunters. Now, can you imagine the embarrassment that would come with purchasing 35 Z Hunters? Seriously, I had to call somebody up. Because I'm at the point now where I'm asking about bulk discounts. Like, I call up a retailer that sells Z Hunters, and I say, "Hi, do you offer bulk discounts?" "Well, sure. What are you interested in?" So at this point, I need to tell this poor lady on the other end, who sounds like a perfectly nice human. I said, flat out, like, "Okay, now you're not going to judge me, right?" She said, no, you're fine, whatever. "Okay, I would like to buy 35 of the ZB-138 bright green zombie knife." This lady starts, like, chuckling. Like, I can tell that she's trying to keep it together. But she's got some jackass on the phone ordering 35 of these. Like, you shouldn't buy one of these, let alone 35 of them. And so she goes off to talk to her manager, presumably sitting there saying, you know, "What the hell is this guy thinking? 35 Z." But they took pity on me, and they offered me a little bit of a bulk discount. And so these guys end up being like $350 or something like that. But anyways, so I get back on the phone. "Yes, we have 35 of these Z Hunters in stock, and we're happy to send them along, give the information, get set up the shipping." And then a week later, I end up with on my freaking doorstep a large flat rate box, which is not a tiny box, containing 35 freaking Z Hunters, which is just ridiculous. I mean, seriously, guys. This is just a small portion of the Z Hunter that occupies my freaking... I can't even. What am I doing with my life at this point? It's brutal. So I have a bunch of Z Hunters now that are signed. Many of them have just terrible actions. This one's pretty good, actually. But I'll end up signed. There you go. And, yeah. So, I'm late to the party. Why the hell are you answering? And so we close up this call, and I say to the lady, "You're not judging me, right?" She says, no, you wouldn't believe the kind of things that some people buy, which makes me suspect. That's the worst part of this story. Like, not only that some jackass out there is willing to order 35 Z Hunters to give away as rewards for the Patreon, but that she says, no. People order way worse. Like, what is worse than ordering 35 of these? Like, what people are making worse life choices than that? And so I judge myself so hard for that. Like, I got to at least bring myself joy that, you know, somewhere there's a 12-year-old who's employed because of me, which is a terrible... No, don't attack the Sleesh Bowie. Bad Z Hunter. Bad. So anyways, that's how I ended up with 35 freaking Z Hunters as Patreon rewards. Oh, I have a problem. Let's see here. Do I use the same Z Hunter? No, this is the Z Hunter. There are many like it, but this one is mine. It's unsigned, and the way I can tell is that this guy has zero stop pin. If we look up here, this has no stop pin, which is why we've got this delightful vertical blade play here. This is the Benchmade edition. Oh, snap. Anyways, complete with a stripped screw and everything here. This is the original Z Hunter that I got, and so this one is near and dear to my heart. The stop pin came flying out when I opened it one day. Oh, this knife. This is spectacular. Absolutely. So no, that is the Z Hunter. The other ones are... I mean, they're the same, but they're not quite the same, if you know what I mean. Let's see here. Do I have a stunt Z Hunter for difficult shots? The Z Stunter? I do not. Actually, come to think of it, I kind of do. I do have a second Z Hunter that was actually sent to me by my buddy Jim, so it's a little near and dear to my heart. And it's actually, the action on this is surprisingly good. Like, this is really a high-end Z Hunter right here. And so this one is my stunt Z Hunter, the Z Stunter, if you will. if I need it. But no, by and large, this one is the one near and dear to my heart. Let's see, could I flip open the buoy? It's been a while. Absolutely. 100%. Here you go, Spyderco Sleash Freaking Buoy right here. The Z-Hunter is indeed assisted, by the way. Let's see here, can the KME knife sharpening system sharpen a razor? I believe so. I haven't tried mine yet, I'm gonna one of these days, but I was able to use it to sharpen the Norseman, and the way that I did that on the Norseman was actually so it's a clamp system, so I clamped it here once, and then did this kind of an affair, and then I did a second clamping where I clamped it like this, and then use the stone in this direction. So I effectively did two sharpenings on it. You can see the nice little line right there where the two meet. Hopefully you can see that. But yeah, so I'm pretty sure that I could do the same thing with the razor where I clamp it right here once and then I clamp it a second time up here. That said, this is a difficult knife to sharpen because it's very easy to make the one cliff blade less flat on a sort of guided system like that, and it's also, it'd be very easy to round this corner off. A buddy of mine had a real horror story with that. He sent it off to a, you know, professional sharpener and came back with something ugly, so it's a shame. Let's see, ever thought about giving the Norseman a zombie paint job to match the Z-Hunter? No. Like, at some level, I would be really amused, and I would cherish such a Norseman forever, but I'm not doing that to mine. I like it as it is. I couldn't carry a green skull. But if John Greensmo, I will say this, if John Greensmo were to ever put out a Rask model that is bright green with skulls on it, I might have to, just to be sure. Let's see here. The Uncle Spoons, are we ever going to get a review of the knife to the right of the Norseman? This guy, the Miura, yep, absolutely, it's coming soon. It's just, it's in my permanent collection, so it always gets bumped by loners. Like these loners right here. Yeah, these are coming. Southern Avo, by the way, which is a nice knife in and of itself. Much smaller than the Tolk, which I reviewed previously, and the Ferrum Forge Scepter here. So there you go. Ogan Matic asks, do you own any EDC fixed blades? So I'm actually going to be doing a video about EDC fixed blades soon and my feelings there. But the answer is no. They don't really work for me particularly well, so it's not something I spend a lot of time with. I used to own an EC Azula too. No, it was a regular Azula. And I've owned a Graham custom EDC fixed blade, but they just never stick around. The folding works better for me. So there you go. What do I think of cold steel? Don't get me started. I've got a bunch of rants on that. Look at any of my cold steel videos. They can make some very nice knives. They have good build quality, and their marketing game is freaking on point. I cannot even begin to tell you how many people I get on any cold steel review, to the point where I almost wonder whether there's money changing hands at times. We're really insistent that there's nothing better, but nonetheless, you know, so I can respect at some level their knife-making skill, although there are other parts of the issue I don't respect at all. So there you go. Let's see here. Let's see, is there red Loctite on the Z-Hunter? No, thank God. Spyderco Rubicon 2 thoughts. I've talked about this a fair amount. You know, I feel like the Rubicon 2 is taking the Rubicon and actually losing a lot of the what made it most interesting and special. The Rubicon was so great because it felt like a custom knife. It was a really incredible, like, oh my God, this is a Spyderco sort of moment, because of the contouring of the scales, because of the polish. I talk about this in the Magnitude review, which, by the way, is for sale for Patreon patrons if anybody wants it. But anyways, the Rubicon 2, they've taken away the contouring on the scales. They've stopped doing the polishing. I believe they've removed the orange backspacer, and they've kept the part of the knife that was honestly least effective, which is the very, very thick blade. So, and with a weird grind and everything on it. So I don't know what the Rubicon 2 is trying for. I feel like that. Scott Decker, so that's a great question, though. Scott Decker asks, would you carry a Benchmade if you had to? Absolutely. Look, as I've said, I mean, I don't feel like Benchmade is a bad company, and they have great designs. If I could pick out a Benchmade Valet, for instance, that had good tolerances, that was well done, that sort of an affair, that had good quality control, I could be very happy with it. In many ways, the Miura and the Valet are similar in size and in overall arrangement. Benchmade Valet is still a solid gem, absolutely, and I wouldn't mind carrying one. It's just none of them have really stuck around for me. So there you go. Am I ever going to review budget knives again, or is that ship sailed? Absolutely I am. I've got a bunch of budget knives handy that I'm going to be doing reviews on. So, for instance, I'm looking over in my drawer full of knives I'm going to review. Here, we'll move some of these guys off the screen. Oh, can't move him, right? I have on the deck here, and again, these are going to be a while, so don't get yourself too up in a dizzy expecting these reviews. But I've got myself here an Issei Zancudo, an Avispa. I've got myself the Kershaw Skyline. I've got a Kershaw, Cricket Swindle here, which is probably my favorite thing that Cricket makes this point in time. What else do I have? I've got a little San Renmu guy. It's a little San Renmu razor, which is pretty entertaining. But that'll be displayed at some point in time. Oh, what else do I have that's beautiful here? And then, Buck Vantage, of course. Anybody who's... And the Tan Flipper. And frankly, I want to do more budget knife reviews. I've been getting a lot of... The thing is, so just going behind the scenes a little bit, with budget knives, it's really awkward. Because imagine that I want to check out, for instance, the Issei's here, the Avispa, the Zancudo. These are great knives, absolutely 100%. If somebody offers to loan me these guys, these knives cost in the vicinity of $20-$30. If somebody offers to loan me one of these, it's awkward because I'm going to pay like $7 or $8 to ship it back to them safely. And at that point, I might as well just buy the knife and take the $7 or $8 bath on shipping myself. And so a lot of these budget knives end up just being something that I buy and then I plan to either give away or give to a friend, to a colleague who doesn't really carry a knife but wants something excellent. So it doesn't make sense for me to take a lot of loan as a high of budget sorts of knives. And I got a bunch of budget knives that are already filmed, by the way, that are going to be trickling out here soon. But it doesn't make sense for me to arrange a loan on a Tan Flipper here. So there you go. Somebody just mentioned a bolt action pen. I forget who it was. Caleb Green? No, that was Rooster Diggs. Right here, this is a Fellholter tie bolt pen, which is a really neat little pen that my buddy, whose name I'm forgetting, Munson, something along those lines. I'm sorry, I'm forgetting your name. But either way, this is another bolt action pen that's kind of, in many ways, archetypical. Archetypal, there we go. It's a nice, nice little pen here. So I'm going to be doing a review of this guy. I got this on loan, so that's nice. Let's see here. Yeah, the D2 steel is a big thing, and this is one of the big appeals for me, actually, is the fact that this Zancudo guy, which is about the same size and in many ways a similar design to your, where the heck is it? Ontario Rat number one here, Rat 2, that is. These are similar knives, but this is in D2 steel, which is a much better steel than the RS8 coming in this. The fact that Ontario hasn't yet shipped a Rat 2 in D2 is, well, it's a tragedy. Perhaps minor in the grand scheme of tragedies in the world, but it's seriously a problem nonetheless. So, there you go. Guys, I've been talking for 62 minutes straight now. My larynx is probably, if I keep going, just gonna fall out and slap right onto the table here, and that's going to be ugly, and it'll probably be a violation of YouTube's content standards and whatnot. So, with this, I think I'm actually going to bid you guys adieu. I'm really hoping that this video turns out okay, that there's no jumping and whatnot, and I'm really grateful for everybody who stopped in and asked great questions. Sorry to everybody whose questions I didn't get to. They're just scrolling by in the corner here, so I just grab what I can. But I hope this was interesting. If it was interesting, let me know in the comments, particularly folks who weren't in the live chat. Let me know if you still enjoyed it. But mostly, I hope that you guys found this interesting and that you have yourselves an absolutely wonderful rest of your day. Bye now.